Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today we are gonna see a very specific topic, which is how to open firewall rules in Google Cloud. This video is connected with a series of videos I'm doing about deploying applications in GCP. In Google Cloud, and this is one of the topics that probably for a channel which is speaking about machine learning and generative AI is not very common, but I wanted to make a short video about how to do it, because I know that most of the people working on this side of business is not very familiar with these kind of things. In case that you are doing projects on your own, maybe at least to have an idea of how you can do this is a good idea. That's what I decided to do it. Okay, so if you follow my channel, you will probably you watch these two videos. I will point you out anyway on the description of this video. We are deploying applications. This application is a bot which uses Gemini AI, Gemini model, Gemini Pro 1.5. I'm doing an application which essentially is interacting with a bot, sending documents, extracting information, providing some information according to and extracting some information from the documents I sent together with the prompts to this model. Again, we are using in the application Gemini, the Gemini via Vertex AI. We deploy the applications in Google, so we use all the services that we had available in there. We started the project deploying the application in the APP engine. We completed like that, and now we are doing something similar to in VM instances. And we already make a video how to create instances and prepare it for the deployment. And the second video, we just deploy the application into a Docker. And finally, we share the application, which is essentially a Streamlit application running on inside the Docker, which wrap all the logic to interact with the final user, and at the same time in the back interact with the model, sending and receiving the prompts and the answers that the model give to us, and this showing obviously the information in the front of the user. At the end of the video we will see a little bit that. So then once we have the application, one of the important points we are working on the cloud is to have if you are deploying the application in a conventional web server or application server, like it could be Fast API or something like that, you may have code some frontend with the HTML, whatever. Well, we decide to use Streamlit, which is an application which allows you to create frontend applications and web applications just purely in Python. And then on this by default, this application running the port 8051. So we need to provide access to this port to anybody from internet to our VM in Google Cloud, which is serving the application into the port 8051 or 85. Let me check. Sometimes I forgot. 8501 or 8051. In any case, the port where Streetlit is serving the applications can be changed. It can be also 80 or 443 is 8501 exactly. So it can be changed. It can is this can be any port so far is not occupied. It can be any port available about 1024 that are reserved ports in TCP. So from 1024 to 535, probably all the ports in this VM are available and you can run the server in any of them. So therefore 80 and 443, well, you can use them because we don't have an HTTP server there, so you theoretically you can open it, but and you had also the default rules already available in the VPC. I will explain you now what is that. But in case that you decide to run it in a non in the generic port or in another port that you want to set up the one, just follow the instructions that you had here, no? So first of all, we create the instance. This is already explained in one of the videos I will post you later on the description of the video. So the only thing that you to set up the rule, you need to go to the network interface and check in which network is located your machine. So it's on the default network, default soft network. So usually when you have different servers in the cloud or in a data center on premise, you usually place the servers depending on their criticality or their risks in different networks. You don't put all of them in the same. This is well, a good practice, a security good practice that is established for more than 25 years. And well, that came from the times that we were working all of us in data centers in on premises. There was not cloud, but this concept it extended or is exactly the same now when we are majoritarily working on the cloud. And the concept that you will see here apply to Google Cloud, to Amazon or to Azure or to any other like Alibaba or any other cloud provider. So usually again we organize the servers into for a in groups in networks, separate networks due to the affinity, the same risks or level of risks, same public exposition. When I say public exposition means like it's a web server or a server like this that needs to be accessed from outside. And then on in between networks, in between the different servers, you had firewalls and routers. A firewall is not more than a router with some filter capabilities in top of the routing capabilities. So it's a component which is more complex. Usually any firewall is also a router and the vice versa not. A router is not a firewall by definition. So usually in between networks, we had firewalls which connect or allow or deny communications in between the different components or servers in our in our company, in our networks, no? In this case it's very simple because we only had a network and we just placed the only VM that we had on the default network. But the scenario that you will have in a conventional company is that you will have multiple networks with multiple subnetworks and you will have to establish the routes and the communications and open the communications in between them. This is a simple example that because internet from the perspective of networking is not more than another network which is external to the networks that we had in our company. So I want to allow that that traffic from outside hit my server where I'm running the Gemini bot in the specific bot of 8051. Secondly, what in the second concept that you need to understand what is a VPC. A VPC is what is the abbreviature of virtual private cloud, and then when you set up an account in any cloud provider, it this comes with a virtual private cloud, the default one. No, the configuration, it depends on the cloud provider. Here is a network with multiple subnetworks in different regions of the Google. More or less, Amazon and Azure work similarly. So you get with your account, with your project here in Google Cloud, you get a VPC, and this VPC, we can take a look now. Let me show you. You can go to VPC network. You have VPCs. And then this, the what you get when you get set up a project, an account in Google Cloud, you get a default VPC with 42 subnets, which is practically one per region available in Google. Yeah, you probably will not use it ever, but this is what they provide by default. No, so I place my computer in the Eurowest one, which is London, UK. So the my server is in this network. But as you can see here, we can place machines in any of these networks. All of them belong, sub networks in this case, that belong to the VPC default. You can create other VPCs, you can create as much as you want, and define other subnets inside these VPCs. This VPC is a component which let's say that is a group of can be a group of subnetworks which logically identified a group inside your company. For example, commercial department or backend or I don't know, databases or application servers, whatever. Or maybe London, Manchester, Madrid, a VPC, and inside this VPC you can set up different networks for different purposes. The question is, everything that is inside the VPC, if you are in the same subnet, you had direct access. So if I place two servers in the default Eurowest one, both of them are going to get an IP version 4 address of this network, and there is no firewall in between them. So I don't need to do anything. So to make a communication in between them. Obviously, if I want to reach one of the servers included in this network, like is the case I'm explaining today, I will have to open a rule from, for example, this case outside to the network itself. The same will happen if I want to if I had a server in this Eurowest one and I had another server in US East one. So both had the one is in Eurowest had an IP address from this net subnet, and the US one had an IP address for this, and then I need to set up at least a firewall rule in between these two networks to allow traffic. It can be from Europe to US, or from West to Europe, depending how you is going to be the connection. You will need to place it either if the origin is in Europe West, you will place it in this, and if the origin is US East, you will have to place it here. So the concept is that you organize finally the all your available servers in different networks, subnets in this case, depending or again the criticality of the server, the data that this server is hosting, the internet exposition, web applications, the fronts are always on the same network, or you can even make some partitions on that to reduce the exposition and the risk of if one of the servers is compromised, the problem is not spread to all the servers that you have in your network. This is the concept segmentation, and it's a very old concept in cybersecurity. This is also implemented. It's a concept that comes from the all networking we had in data centers, and now this concept is reused and applied exactly the same when you are working on the cloud. And then just I give you all this insight to finally set up the rule. Well, you will not find usually this configuration in, it's just here a very simple project in Google Cloud. Usually there is hundreds of VPCs, hundreds of networks, the security and the communications in between servers in a company is a topic very, very serious, and it's very complex in many cases, because there is and obviously when you have hundreds of thousands of servers in different regions, different networks, the complexity of setting up firewall rules is really high. So it's nothing easy. You need to have a very good background in terms of the networking, TCP/IP stack, and also how the firewall works, what are the concepts, and so on and so forth. For this very simple case, we just simply can open a firewall and define a rule to be able to connect to our server, but probably in most of the scenarios where you are working in a company, there are a special team in your company which is in charge of the security. Practically all the companies I know, especially if you are a little bit medium size, or even small medium size, and well, the big companies 100%, they have special teams which are in charge of the security and also to implement this kind of thing. So you will probably only need to do a ticket and ask for to open a rule in the firewall to allow these kind of connections. Okay, here we are going to do it ourselves, and then the concept we had the Debian in our default VPC is in a subnet, which is the subnet Europe West 1. You can go to the machine, it's 1054. Well, it's an overrun. I put Europe West B, so it had to be, yeah, exactly 1054.08. So exactly it's USB that one. So inside the subnets I had available is in that one, in the Eurodwest 2. Okay, so the next thing that you need to do is understand which port you need to open. Well, first of all, let's go to the IPs, which is gonna be is previous to understand the port. Okay. Our server had two IP addresses. It's a multi-home server. All of them will have minimally two IP addresses. One is the one that is used to be exposed to internet, regardless that you use it or not, it will have one. And the other one is for internal communications in between services or in between servers in your VPC or other VPCs that belong to your account. This is the all the communications done with the primary internal IP address, or internal IP address will be used to communications inside GPC. The one you have external is just to expose the service to internet. Some cases you don't need it, so you don't do anything with that, and in some other cases you need it. In our case, these two IP addresses are ephemeral, meaning that every time that you reboot the machine, they change. They are in a network, so it will get another IP address from the same network. This is a C class. Probably there is 254 available in the C class. You will get one of the available in that network. And the same happens with the external IP address. Then on, to change that, what we will do is you go, where is, sorry, I forgot, IP addresses. And you can see here the two IP addresses we have in our machine. When you have multiple servers, all of them will be here. As you can see, the internal is ephemeral and the external is static. Why I did that? Well, if I need to reboot the server, I don't want to lose this IP address because it's the one that I already give to the users to connect to the service. So if you want to set the IP address as static, you just need to click here in the three dots and promote the to a static IP address. So in my case, I don't care if the internal IP address is ephemeral, because the rules to connect to other internal servers are how to say, defines at network level, not at server level. But in some scenarios, you may need to as well set up the IP address static, and then on set up a firewall rule to just allow the server to do a connection to somewhere else. This is also possible. That's why you have as well here the option. Once you have set up your external IP address to static, you can set up a label just to later on identify correctly. When you have hundreds of IP addresses, you need sometimes to identify them correctly. And well, here, when the IP address is not static. Sorry. Yeah, when it's not static, simply you cannot add labels, because obviously this IP address will change. Keep an eye on the IP address, on the IP address, because later we will need this for the rule. Now the latest step is to set up the firewall. So here again, this is a very simple example. I set up a rule. When you go to the default, we are in the default VPC. We go to the firewall rules of the VPC, and you set up a new rule. Create a firewall rule, and it's gonna be something. Let's do it like this. Okay, easy. So you here give a name and provide a description. Try to provide a name that help you to identify what this rule is doing. In between the name and the description, you have to be It has to be crystal clear what this rule is doing. Why I say that? Because, as you can imagine, when you had hundreds or thousands of rules and different servers in a rule base, in a firewall, you can very quickly lose the track of what the rules are doing. And then it's critical to understand in a very simple, at a simple view, that what the firewall rule is doing. Many times in the description, we are just simply doing a short description of what the firewall rule is doing, and also you include the ticket that produce this rule, who authorize it, for what is for which project, just to give a context, because again, when the time is going on, when the time pass, you after 6 months, 2 years, the next or the next security or the next firewall administrator who take the your job is not going to understand, is not going to have the context, and so is crucial and key and very important to have this correctly documented, because the security of the whole company is depending on the how correctly is the firewall rules are implemented. So later you can activate the logs. This is important as well if the service that is for what is intended to this rule is critical or is need to be monitored constantly. You will keep it forever. This is going to track everything accessing or hitting this rule. And in some cases, if the rule is well, how to say, a conventional communication in between two servers in your company, they activate it after you are sure that the communication is happening as expected. It doesn't matter if it is allowed or denied, ingress or egress. Activate it for a while and then remove it just to avoid excessive logging. The network to which apply, as you can see here, we only have one, but again, it can be hundreds of them. Priorities. When you have you can have multiple rules, ones more specific than others, and then on is where the priority applies. Imagine that you have a rule which allows to a server be hit on a port. Specific port, let's say 4444, and you had another rule which allow to different servers, or which deny different servers arrange or the same port 4044, and then on you want one for this network to be allowed but the rest to be deny. So what you do, you set up a rule with priority, for example, 1000, which allow the traffic to this server, to this IP address on that port, and with a lower priority, the same rule, but to the whole network, denying the traffic. When the firewalls analyze the traffic, it's doing sequentially for top. It's a top-down process. It takes the more the rule with the highest priority and start to analyze up to the low as to the rule with the lowest priority. So it you the if you are the hit try to hit the right target, the right IP address which have the right IP address, the one which had the higher priority, the traffic will be allowed. And if you try to access another server on the same port in the same network, which is not in the priority rule, it will hit the second rule, which is denying the traffic. This way, you can set in different priorities. First of all, you also, which is another important concept, is setting up priorities for the more concise, no, and stricter rules or more use rules at the beginning with higher priority, and the more general rules and the default rule which is blocking all at the bottom with the lowest priority. That's why, because when a communication tries to cross a firewall, all the rule base can be analyzed, and it has to be somehow efficient. The rules that are more hit at the beginning, and the rules which are more specific at the beginning, and the more general and at the bottom, in order to speed up the process and to get a little bit more performance. So this is again, this is a technique. You need to know very well how this is set up, and then in case that you are this, probably you will not be in charge to do it. Because again, this usually when the networks become very complex, you need to have the experience and know very well how the protocol works, how the firewalls works, and this is not an easy job. But well, for this case, I just wanted to show you how to do this simple stuff and where to go, and just continue with your project. No? Traffic ingress, this is clear, no? Incoming traffic or egress traffic. This also is from the perspective of the VPC. You have two VPCs, two internal VPCs in Google Cloud. Depending where you set up the rule, can be ingress or egress, depending where is the source and where is the target. And the action is allow or deny, depending again how you want to, if you want to allow the traffic or you want specifically deny the traffic to the port or to the IP address or to the network. Well, here now targets, it can be all instances in that network. Specific target tags, you can set tags per network, host, service, etc., etc. And also you can set up specific service accounts. Service accounts is a security component, a service account which allows you to work with multiple services. You entitle or you grant access to different services or different components of the infrastructure, and then on everything that is allowed to do the service account is considered like a group, no? And then you can you probably want to just set up all the components that are allowed to access this service account to be hit in some specific port. So here we are going to set up for now all instances in the network. Here now we filter the traffic. This is as well, you can filter the source IP address. Usually is something that is very common. In our case, as we want to hit from internet to an internal machine in our VPC, we will have to do we will have to set up the rule to all hosts, any host with any IP address, sorry, zero. But again, you can set up multiple only networks or specific IP addresses or ranges of IP addresses which just can hit only IP addresses from that source can hit your server. In the case of internet, again, 0.0.0.0/0, everybody can hit that. You can set up a second filter, just as you want, and destination filter. Destination filter is quite interesting. This is essentially the internal IP address of your server, or internal network IP address of your server. Let me show you again, that was in VPC network IP addresses. So I told you, remember this, you can filter now to everybody that is in this network, or this even this IP address, you can set it static. You can just simply say, Let me copy, sorry. I want traffic to this IP address, and only to this IP address will be allowed. This way, here we open the targets, is all targets in the network, but here just we are restricting to the IP address of the machine that I want to be reached. From where? From any direction in internet. Then on protocols. We have three types of protocols: TCP, IP, stack, TCP, UDP, and others. Usually it's gonna be a TCP port. I didn't provide the name. So that's why it's at least one protocol. So you will just specify a protocol. Here you can follow ranges, you can create ranges of ports, ranges of the, or separated by comma if you want to specify multiple ports, UDP, TCP, and others. Others like IPsec or some LPT2P. Exactly. Some protocols for encryption, depending. Some protocols are complex and you need to identify them by their name. And the firewall understand that when this traffic try to cross, is, for example, you can see here IPsec, which is an encryption protocol, or even SFTP, or some protocols which are the combination of the TCP, IP, and others protocols at the lower level. You can specify there. And that's all. Once you have it, you can create the firewall. I will show you how it looks like, the rule I had already created from my machine. So I open to all, let me edit in that case. I log in the traffic, ingress all instances in the network, and the destination can be only to the IP address in this network. Why? Because we had ephemeral here, so this can change anything anytime that I reboot. I don't want to spend more money in making this, reserving this IP address. It's not a lot, but well, it's just for this small POC. I don't want to spend more money. And what's all? IP ranges, destination IP address, my port, and that's all. Now you can see we can hit the. Let me show you. We can hit the application. You can see the IP address here. So we had our prompts. Yeah, everything is working. You can refresh the application. And it's working. Now my next objective is provide a name to this service, because, well, just to make it easily identifiable by for the users, because the IP address, well, you, for a technical person is fine, for the users usually not easy to recognize the public IP address. O sea, the IP addresses, they prefer names. And that's all. It's a very extensive topic, not usual to be commented in this kind of chats. I just wanted to give you some introduction to this in case that you want to replicate everything I'm doing in this project. I will again point you out to the two previous videos where I describe how to create the machine, install the application, etc. And this part is also important. If you don't complete it, obviously you will not be able to access the application, which is contained in a Docker in the EVN, just in case you want to try it in your site. And that's all. Thank you very much for watching. And as I usually say, subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before. Give me a like if you enjoyed with the video and it was useful for your job and your training. And share the content with all your colleagues just to help me to promote the channel in YouTube. Here you see here, this is the hits, just a final remark. When you activate the log, you can see here the who is hitting your IP address. And if you take any specific log, you can identify looking at the logs, whatever. Let me, where, for example, the location. This is somebody from Spain accessing. Let's check here. Remote location. This is probably myself from England. Ah, yeah. The rule that was heated. That one, street lit. The VPC. All the details that you need to the later the book. What's going on, why my service is not working, you can just go to the logs and understand. Because again, when you have a network problem or a firewall problem, trying to identify what is the reason, it is the firewall, it is the routing, it is the server, it is the application, it's quite complex. And well, up to the application is not fully deployed, it's a good idea always keep the login and see it well. At least you can say the firewall is not the problem in this case. So the firewall is being traversed, so it's allowed. We are logging the traffic, and well, at the end we can say, okay, if we have a problem, the problem is clear that it's not in the firewall. Probably somewhere else, not here. Okay, again, that's all. Thank you very much for watching and see you soon.